for a company called Woolworths.
Oh, well remember. Really good company, very solid.
Solid, yeah. Salary pension scheme.
Yeah, been here forever.
Yeah.
Job for life.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
See me through to the end of my days.
Absolutely.
Till the 12th of December 2008.
Yeah.
When it all crashed,
yeah.
Yeah, no payoff, didn't even get paid till the end of the month.
Yeah.
Pension went to the wall, our life made the wall change.
Yeah. Now, it's a, I was going to say an interesting, that maybe doesn't really do it justice, really, but it's, for lack of a better word, it's an interesting situation that so many people are in a job that it might be a good job. I mean, I remember when I was 16 and I was at school and I wasn't really enjoying school. Only when I got to do A-levels to kind of enjoy it because I discovered beer and women in the sixth form, which was good. But before that, I didn't really enjoy school that much. I wasn't very good at it. And I kind of thought about leaving school to be a magician. Great idea, great future, really. And my mum said, look, do whatever you want to do, but you know, whatever you do, you know, make sure you're happy. And she said at the time, why don't you do a good job, a really good safe job? Go into something like banking. Great advice, right? Because look what happened to the bank. So the problem is there is no such thing as a job for life anymore. And I think the problem is many people are in jobs with big, good companies. I mean, you know, Woolworths, it was an institution, wasn't it?
Yeah, 30,000 people.
You know, and you know, who would have thought something like that? You know, all the banks that went under in the crisis. And you know, people have very good jobs, they thought, jobs for life. There's no such thing as a job for life anymore. So if you don't take responsibility for your future, you know, you're leaving it in someone else's hands and this kind of thing can happen. So I imagine that must have been a pretty devastating time.
It was, but I was determined that I wasn't going to go back into the corporate life.
Right, okay.
But I didn't know what to do. I was a project manager, that meant going back into corporate.
Yeah.
So I spent a few years looking around. We'd always wanted to get into property, but knew that you needed loads of money to do that.
Yeah, of course you need loads of money to get into
it. And we didn't have that, obviously.
Yeah.
So I did a few things, ended up, the height of my career was delivering shopping for Sainsbury's.
Okay, yeah.
Which is actually a great job if you want to know what your local area is like. Yeah. You go through all the different streets, you see them different times of the day, you meet the people, you can find some great properties.
Yes.
So I actually did my apprenticeship without realising I was doing my apprenticeship. And then somebody... No,
when we said get to know the area, that's a little excessive, Kevin.
But, you know, decided I need to get a bit of education. Didn't know where to go, so I went to Amazon.
Yes.
I bought three books, the top three.
So yeah.
I actually bought and paid for Property Magic.
Yes. Yeah, some people do that. Yeah.
Apparently, yeah. I didn't know what I know now.
Yeah.
And then I went to a massive local networking meeting. Which absolutely terrified me.
Yes.
There was like 200 people in the room.
Yeah.
All talking about property. I know nothing about it.
Yeah.
Luckily, I found myself in a corner by the YPN table.
Yes.
And they were selling obviously the magazine. And
yeah.
They introduced me to this thing called a pin meeting.
Right. Okay.
Just down the road, where there'd be less people but nicer people.
Yeah.
And there was some guy.
Oh, that's nice.
There was some guy talking there that actually written this book.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And a week ago for free.
There you go.
What
brilliant.
Was there
to lose?
Yeah. So we went along. And
I think I remember us meeting actually. Yeah.
I certainly do. And I was convinced that we should do the one-day course.
Yeah. I think Sally needs to have a word here now.
No, it's fine. Because I knew.
We know who the boss is really, but that's fine.
I knew what I was going to be like. You're yes. going to just upsell all day long.
Yeah, exactly.
So
not actually tell you anything.
I spent all my time like this.
Yeah.
Through the whole day. Didn't. Thankfully, somebody was a little bit more open-minded.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Okay. It was a hell of a journey back from Birmingham to Frimley.
Yes.
Having said that we weren't going to do anything.
Yeah.
Anymore.
Right, okay.
Very quiet
journey.
So let's
go to Sally. Let's hear a little bit from Sally now, I think. So Sally, we'll come back to what you did bring me, but this is an interesting topic here. So sometimes partners don't always get it, do they?
That's right, absolutely. I could see it's what we needed to do, and I could see we needed to do it, not only from the income point of view, but actually giving Kevin the confidence that he'd lost through redundancy,
yeah.
To be honest with you. And I'd been supporting him, as we all do, but I could see that there was a lot more than just knowledge of property that was coming here. It was all about mindset as well, confidence, getting out of your comfort zone, which is what you needed to do. and having that support. So that's why I, and he'd probably say nagged, I'd say encouraged.
It's a difference between language between men and women. same, different, yeah.
That's what we needed to do, is that we needed to take that next step and do Accelerator.
Okay, so that was a 3-day course, which you then came on. And then what was your view after that?
The first part of that, I thought, well, if nothing else, I'm going to spend 3 days with Sally in a nice hotel and some good food.
Yes, so we always pick nice hotels and make sure we have good food.
Yeah. And the first thing we were told to do, and I know Andy's changed this now since then, is that you need to split up, because networking separately is a really good thing.
Yeah.
So at that point, I nearly walked out.
Yeah.
Thankfully, I didn't. And then something changed.
But what was it about not splitting up that you didn't like? We've been very, it's just between us here. What was it?
That was the whole objective of the weekend.
To spend time with Sally?
Yeah.
Not with a random load of strangers learning about property, which you weren't really sure if you wanted to do or not anyway.
Absolutely, no.
Okay,
no.
Right.
Mr. Cynic, absolutely.
Yeah, okay.
But then something happened over those 3 days that at the end of those 3 days, I remember very clearly writing in the back of my book, I can do this. The only thing that's going to stop me is me.
Yeah.
And I was the second person to sign up for the Mastermind program after that.
Right.
The other one was nearer to the desk than me. Because I knew that I needed that support and that accountability and that help. Because I knew what would happen.
Yeah.
The first deal we came across that didn't quite work, it would be, oh, it's okay for all these other people. They know how property is. It's obviously not for me.
Yeah.
And that would have been it.
Do you want that ability to check deals with other people, get a second opinion or a 20th opinion, as the case might be?
Yeah, and that whole support and that whole mindset thing, which was massive for me.
Yeah,
it's really what I needed. Yeah.
Okay.
I can say from my point of view, and I'm sure some of you are sitting here thinking this today. The 3 days was such an intensive course. It's a brilliant course, but I felt totally, totally overwhelmed with it all because there is so much content in it. And I was really mindful that we would walk away and have all good intentions and nothing would happen.
Yeah.
Because life would then take over.
Happens, doesn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. So I knew that the only way we were actually going to move forward in this was to take that action and sign up. It was as simple as that, because then we've got that accountability.
Yeah. Okay. Now, Kevin, you actually came on the programme, obviously, kind of very much because obviously you, when you're on the programme, you know, Sally can look on the forum, got the recordings of the event so you could listen in. So obviously Sally very much helping you, supporting you, but you were the main man at the front line taking the flak if you didn't do the stuff, basically.
I had to make sure I really listened during the whole day, because I had to go back and report on every single bit.
Exactly.
Listen to the audio and answer any questions.
Yes, because people say, do I have to come with a partner? And actually, if you're two of you doing it, it's really good if one of you goes back, because by you then teaching Sally, you not only keep her up to date, but you're learning about it yourself.
And teaching a teacher is quite something.
Yes. So Simon, let's talk about teaching, because talk about that background and your background and what you're now doing.
Okay, so my background was in teaching, and I've done that. I did that for 25 years, on and off. 10 years, 11 years, and then 14 years. I had a break, and I worked for 10 years in a state agency that started off as just a part-time, and then it grew from that. I wish I knew then what I know now.
Hang on a minute. So you were an estate agent?
Yeah.
How long?
10 years.
10 years.
Manager of an estate agent.
So senior in an estate, and you didn't know any of this stuff?
Nope.
And do you think that's the case for most estate agents?
Absolutely.
And yet, don't estate agents say to investors, hey, this is a great investment opportunity?
And they haven't got a clue.
They haven't got a clue, isn't that interesting? Now, we are generalising, obviously. There are one or two estate who might be doing it themselves, but the vast majority, they're just salespeople. And they might know what the values in an area are, but they have no idea about the rentals.
No.
How many of you have been to an estate agent, right? And they say, here's a great investment property. And you say to them, how much would it rent for? And they say, oh, I don't know, we don't do rentals.
Yeah.
I mean, who's had that experience? Yeah? You think, well, and they just don't get it, do they?
No, absolutely not. And they don't talk about return on investment. In fact, they don't know what return on investment is.
They talk about just yield, don't they?
Yield.
Which is completely pointless, because it doesn't take effect of all the account, costs into account.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And you're not taught, as an estate agent in the training, anything about working with investors.
No. Because investors are kind of like...
Oh!
they're like the devil's children, aren't they?
Yeah.
Because they make these low offers, they mess around, they don't really follow through.
Yeah.
And this is why so many investors struggling with estate agents because they're wondering, they've done a course, they say, I've come to buy all the below market value properties, and the estate agents roll their eyes and go, here's another one.
Yeah.
Take the card, file it under B, don't call us, we'll call you, and wonder why the agent never comes back.
Yeah, absolutely.
Having said that, if you know how to speak to agents, they can bring some great deals, can't they?
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah? We've got deals with estate agents because of building that relationship and understanding where they're coming from.
Excellent. So let's talk about some of your deals. So we can go to the slides, please. And you picked two deals to kind of talk through here, I think. So let's talk through this one first of all.
So this was our very first project.
Okay.
So on Mastermind, we're told to meet with all the local masterminders.
Yes.
It took me about 3 months to do that.
Yeah. People don't always do what they're told straight away, do they?
Not, no.
Because do they try and work out their own way of doing stuff?
Yeah.
So it's much smarter, right?
No.
Thank you. By the way, thank you for your honesty. This is very, we appreciate this, don't we, guys?
Yeah.
By the way, is it really useful to hear what normal people have found and how they've done just amazing things? Is it useful?
Yeah.
Great, okay.
So we go to our local team meeting.
Yeah.
And we meet a mastermind that's on the program before us.
Yeah.
Who has some deals through sending letters out to landlords.
Yeah.
But she's also got some of those that she doesn't want herself.
Yeah. And that's sometimes because they're out of area, don't fit strategy, all sorts of things.
These were because they were all in the student area.
Right.
She didn't want to do students.
Okay.
And they were basically landlords that couldn't find students because it was the year when the fees went up.
Oh, right. So there was a bit of a drop in the applications.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely. So I approached her, and I also approached her with another masterminder that was on our course that we then spoke to each other. And we looked at it and we decided, well, yes, we can actually do something because of where there's actually two properties. And we thought, okay, well, I'll take one and you take the other.
Yeah.
And then we thought, well, actually, no, that's not the smartest way of working together. What we'll do, there's two properties, we'll work together.
Yeah.
So then we decided to work together. Even though it was just a rent to rent, there was no money to put into it.
Yeah.
We were both learning. We were both terrified at what we were doing, to be honest.
Yeah.
But sharing that
being load, terrified together somehow reassuring.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And then we
share the fear, that's what they call it.
And then we found we got different strengths as well.
Yeah.
So that was absolutely brilliant. And we decided that we found a local charity that we could work with.
Yeah.
And ended up on the first day that we had these two properties of five rooms each, putting 10 tenants in.
On the first day?
On the first day.
Yeah.
All in one go.
Yeah.
So the first time we'd ever brought a tenant into a house.
Yeah.
We did it 10 times.
Yeah.
So that was a pretty massive learning.
Absolutely.
And yeah, there was loads of learnings. The negotiation with the landlord was quite difficult. And we had a bit of help, which we could have done without with. So if we'd have had more confidence in our own ability, we'd have actually made the deal better.
Yeah.
But we still went on because it was learning how to manage an HMO.
Yeah.
None of our own money.
Yeah.
And we were making some money out of it each month as well.
Yeah. Now, difficult tenants, you know, LHA tenants, I personally don't want LHA tenants in my multi-lets. I've got them in single lets, but they take a lot more management, don't they?
I remember having that conversation.
Yeah.
Hmm. But
didn't listen to me.
Yeah, we did.
Okay.
We took it on board.
Okay.
And we knew it would be challenging.
Yeah.
And it was.
Yeah.
But
I mean,
think
you can make money doing it. You make good money, but it's hard work.
It was hard work.
Yeah.
But what it was, because it was our first two properties, we learned a lot about tenants.
Yeah.
A huge amount.
There's no replacement for actually doing it, is there? Because you can sit in a classroom all day long, but until you actually get there and think, oh, that's what we were told about. You kind of get the learning through experience, don't you?
Yeah.
That's the best way.
And we hadn't risked any of our own money or anybody else's money.
Yeah, okay.
And then what happened is, literally 2 weeks later, the landlord came back to us and offered us the next property.
Okay.
Which was a much better one, 7-bed. And we were able to make much more money out of that one, just because of where it was and the type of rooms. And again, not a huge amount of profit, but it was much more money than we currently had coming in, and we hadn't put any of our own money in.
So one of the great things, I just want to make sure you picked up this distinction. The first properties were in a student area, and the landlord was struggling to rent them out to students. And this happens because sometimes, you know, there was, say, a dip in the application to students. There are these purpose-built student buildings that go up, and sometimes students like those because they're nice and shiny and, you know, et cetera. They're more expensive. And so This happens, and now that landlord, sometimes they've got quite a lot of property, quite experienced, but sometimes landlords and investors get stuck in their mindset. And they think, this is a student house, I can't get students. And these idiots are prepared to give me a guaranteed rent. Brilliant. And these idiots happen to realise, actually, we're not idiots, because we can repurpose it and put different people in. Yep. And this is a point. You see, sometimes people have been really successful, they get so tunnel vision, they think what they're doing is the only way, and they think someone else is prepared to pay when they don't get what we get.
Yep.
Because they have a closed mind, don't they? Even though they've been successful, they've been on one route, and they don't know what they don't know.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah? And then, once you've done one deal with a landlord, you go back, and if it works, then they might offer up other opportunities. So this is another great one. So talk to us a bit more about this one, and explain why the landlord wanted to do this particular property.
This one he'd got it was right on the edge of the student area, and again, it was one he couldn't let.
Right.
The big learning and the big challenge for this was, if we'd have spent a significant amount of money on it, we could have increased the rents.
Right.
And it would have made it a really beautiful property.
Yeah.
But we only had it on a 3-year deal.
Right.
We never got our money back.
If it's rent to rent, you won't spend too much money.
No, absolutely.
If it's a purchase lease option, you've got the right to buy, then you might want to spend the money.
And we tried that, but he wasn't having that because he thought that the market would come back.
Yes.
Now, as it happened, it worked out really well because towards the end of the 3 years, we moved out to Devon and Bernadette, our business partner, moved to Wales. So
yeah.
We really didn't want these three properties anymore.
Yes.
So it was ideal. We could give them back to him.
Yeah.
With no.
You just had the great cash flow.
Yeah.
So
cash flow
$8,000 plus each year.
Yeah.
On a property you didn't put any money into.
And giving us the confidence then to go ahead and work with money. We took some money out of our own property and bought some more properties that way. Work with other people now with their money as well. So all those things, we've got stuff on purchase lease options. So it just gave us the confidence to go ahead
You've done such a great job from a position where you didn't really have the confidence because of what happened to you, kind of going baby. And I think sometimes people try and run too fast, don't they? But by doing baby steps, by working with other people in the group, and sharing the learning experience and sharing the risk to a certain extent, you've achieved a lot more.
Yeah, and we were very, very clear on our reason why.
Yeah.
We never had any desires to become, own 100 HMOs or anything like that.
No.
It was all about just replacing our income and then a bit more.
And you've been really smart by just having that focus. Yeah. So obviously you've now replaced your income.
Yep.
And you just said last year or the year before moved. So talk about the move. What's that all about?
Okay, so Mastermind enabled me to give up part-time work, so to go part-time teaching. And then 6 months after finishing that, I could actually give up completely because of the income generated. And then we sat there and thought, why are we living in this house? Because on our bucket list, when we started doing the vision board, as Simon says, we'd put right at the very bottom to move to the seaside. We'd love the sea and we wanted to move down by the coast. And actually, I'll tell you something, Simon's got a really good memory, because when we had dinner with him on Mastermind Accelerator, we told him this. And 2 years later, maybe a year and a half later, one of the things he said to us was, how are you getting on with your move to the coast? Which we'd kind of almost forgotten, because it was down the bottom of our list.
It's the hidden cameras we've got on your house that help you remember that.
Anyway, and that really prompted us to think, why are we living where we're living? We are now in a position where we are financially free and we can go and live anywhere. So we started to look at the coast, and it then happened that exited PIN.
Now at the same time, wasn't it, on listening to the PIN Academy CD,
you
mentioned you're opening up a PIN in Exeter.
Yes.
I thought, that's kind of spooky, because that's what we'd always wanted to do, but there's too many PINs where we live to be able to do that. And that was kind of where we wanted to live. So I remember calling you and saying, have you got anybody for it yet? No,
yes, I have. I just hadn't told you.
Yeah. But you don't live down there. When do you want to start? We'll be there.
Yeah.
And we were. And we are.
So 2.5 years ago, we launched Exeter PIN, and we moved down to the coast, and we live by the sea now. 7-minute walk to the sea. We can see the sea from our house, and we live the life of the dream.
Fantastic. And so talk briefly about PIN, and what's PIN done for you, as in hosting a PIN meeting? How's that changed things?
I think the first thing it did was introduce us to the local area, which was obviously key, introduce us to local investors in the area.
Yeah.
It's helped us to find some great deals, and it's helped us to find people that we now work with.
Yeah. And you have a kind of credit, and again, it's just stepping up the credibility, isn't it? When you've done some deals, that helps. In-house, that's some credibility as well, isn't it?
And I think what's also important to us is we've actually helped other people to do the same.
Yeah, that feels really amazing, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it really does, yeah. And people that have done even better than us.
Then
they feel like our children in a way.
It's a teacher
coming
out now.
Yeah, brought them into our PIN meeting, nurtured them, they've gone on to even better, more success than us. And then we stand there like the proud parents, yes!
Fantastic. So, any final things you want to share with people?
Just do it. I think you've got to be persistent.
It's not all easy, is it?
It's not easy, no, but you have the support to get through that. If you're just persistent, and I suppose doing what Simon says.
Yeah, that's the best advice.
And trusting the process. Once you've signed up to it, you've kind of done all the due diligence, you've just got to make it happen then.
Yeah.
And
like John said, it's kind of down to you, isn't it?
It's down to you. There are no excuses.
Everything you need, take away all the excuses.
There's enough evidence of enough people that have done it.
Yeah.
And quite frankly, if we can do it in our position, with our knowledge or lack of knowledge at that time, anybody can do it.
I think it's done a fantastic job, you know. And not everyone makes the £50,000 in the first year, people do more the second year. How have you kind of progressed or elevated after the first year?
It's over doubled our income.
Right.
And obviously there's a little bit of a gap because when we moved, we decided to invest in the local area.
Yeah.
So we spent a bit of time finding out the best areas.
Yes.
That,
so you research.
Doing the research. Yeah. That's a little bit of a delay. But now we're just finding so many deals now.
Would you agree that when you know what to do, there are more deals than you could possibly do yourself?
Oh,
definitely.
Yeah.
Definitely in that situation.
But it takes a while to get to that point, doesn't it?
Yes.
Some people scrap it and they can't find deals, and I think it's probably because they don't know what a deal is, so they're not taking enough action, as you said.
Absolutely.
Mastermind's the beginning, and a lot of people when they go on mastermind think that at the end of the year, that's it. But actually mastermind is the beginning, and you're never going to unlearn what you learn, And that's, and if you carry on, that support is there. We've made lifelong friends. If we looked back in January 2013, if someone had said to me, we'd be living where we're living, earning what we're earning, passive income, living the life we're living, doing what we're doing, being part of this really supportive environment.
The friends that we've got.
With the friends that we've made over the way, I would never have believed it.
No.
Absolutely, I'd have thought you're joking. Yeah. No way it can happen. And we're living proof.
And sometimes it's things like adversity, like redundancy, which at the time is a pretty terrible, catastrophic thing happening, and it's about how you choose to respond to that, isn't it? Because life's going to throw stuff at you, and actually sometimes people think when you have all this property and you have all this income coming in, life's easy. No, it's not easy. What happens is you just get better at dealing with bigger problems. But it's the point about how you decide to either do something about it, take personal responsibility, or you decide, well, I'm just going to get another job and let someone else be responsible for my future. So I think we should give them a massive round of applause. Thanks so much for sharing.